Our next speaker, very special person. I first met Tom Tancredo in 1998 when he was one of six aspiring GOP primary candidates running in the 6th District Republican primary in Colorado. So actually, he was here at a little fundraiser in Washington, D.C., and I remember hearing him speak about his stand on immigration, and I was thinking, gosh, you know, can this guy really, you know, get elected to Congress, and is he going to make any difference, and should I open up my checkbook and make a contribution, not a large one, but a contribution to him? I had no idea, none of us did at the time, that the guy that was asking us to support his campaign would play such a critical and pivotal role in 2006 and 2007. When almost single-handedly, you know, he had the courage to stand up and the courage of his convictions to stand up to his own party's leadership, his own party's president, to the Chamber of Commerce, the AFL-CIO, La Raza, John McCain, Karl Rove, the major religious organizations, every major newspaper you can think of, and actually stand them down and lead the charge that beat them. One of the greatest grassroots legislative victories for the people of all time. And he was the man, really, mainly many people participated, but if it hadn't been for Tom Tancredo, I can tell you we probably would have lost. We would not have won those great battles. So the American people owe him a huge debt of gratitude. I don't need to introduce him. You know his record. You know what he's done for us. I just ask you to give him a great round of welcome.
Thank you. Thanks, Casey. As Casey was being so kind with that introduction, I was thinking about those times, and specifically when I chose to sort of cap that career, I guess, in at least in elected politics, at least I thought it was at the time, capping my career, when I decided to run for, seek the nomination of the Republican Party for President of the United States in 2007. And I, in fact, did that only for one reason, I assure you, and that was because I wanted to advance this issue. And that's the only place, that was the last place I could go. I mean, I felt just about everything I could do where I was in the Congress, burned as many bridges as there were to burn, made as many enemies as you could possibly make, and both your own party and the opposing party. And it seemed like that was the next step, although I was in great trepidation of doing so. I mean, I was this, you know, who am I to seek this? I remember going to Pat Buchanan and saying to him, because Babe Buchanan was my campaign manager, and when we were partners on this issue, of course, even before I ran for the presidency, and she kept suggesting this, and I kept saying, well, Bay, let's get Pat to do it again. And, you know, and I went and begged him. I begged. 1 hour and 10 minutes we spent at his favorite Chinese restaurant, Bay and I, literally begging him to do it again. And he just sat there for like an hour. We went through this, you know, and he sat there and listened, and then he said, nope. And I said, oh, after all this, no, that's all you've got. No, why? He says, I can't take Iowa again. Now, having been through the experience, I totally understand what he was talking about now. Iowa is challenging in many respects. But I want to tell you that although I am seen, I know what my persona is out there, my public persona about politics, especially about immigration, and, you know, this really hard-ass guy about it, and people would suggest other things. I mean, I've certainly had the epithets thrown at me for a long time, racist, 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 and all that sort of thing. But I want to tell you that I'm going to give you one little thing that happened, one little anecdote that happened that shows you I'm not as bad as they say. I'm running. This is the first debate, presidential debate, Reagan Ranch. I am scared to death. Just to be on the stage there was, you know, and I meet Mrs. Reagan before we, and you know, Reagan Library, it's just my, you know, it's like walking in hallowed ground. And so we practice for weeks trying to make sure that every question I could possibly get, no matter what it was about, I was going to try to turn it into an illegal immigration answer. And so we went through, and it's not that hard, really, I'm not kidding you, when you think about, you know, you want to talk about education? I'll talk about education. I'll talk about what illegal immigration is doing to the education. You want to talk about health care? I'll talk about health care and what illegal immigration is doing to our health. So it wasn't, you know, you could go through about every major category and pretty much come down with how you were going to respond and make sure it turned into it, because that's the only reason I'm there. I'm not going to be president of the United States. Not for a millisecond did I think I was going to be president of the United States. But so there I was, you know, there were nine of us, and I think Ron Paul was on one end and I was on the other end, and I'm just, all my knees are shaking. I am really just honestly so scared, and I just kept saying, illegal immigration, illegal immigration, illegal immigration, illegal immigration, you know? And so I'm waiting, and every question that would come up for somebody else, I mean, I got nothing for, you know, like 40 minutes. I'm standing there. No questions. They're all to the, you know, I always said the tall guys with good hair. And then Giuliani got in, and I couldn't say that anymore. But, you know, to the major candidates, all the questions. But every one that questioned to go, I'd think to myself, illegal immigration, illegal. I know how to answer that, illegal immigration. And so finally, Chris Matthews says to me, and so, Congressman Tancredo, we have a question from the audience here, and for you. And I said, oh, good. Whew, illegal immigration, illegal immigration, illegal immigration. He goes, so as President of the United States, what would you do to increase organ donors? And I'm thinking, illegal immigration. But I will tell you, I did not respond with illegal. Which goes to show you, I really am a nice guy, you know? And I said something brilliant. What? What did you say? Organ donors? Make it a market, you know, I don't know, oh my goodness, it was terrible, so we're just, I felt horrible about it, and things went downhill from there, but, and especially because of one of my opponents on that stage at the time, of course, was John McCain, and was the worst of all of them on the issue. None of them were any good, but he was the worst, and after that was, let's see, we started in February and I ended it in December, because the whole thing was, the deal I had with Bay was that I would do this until we could get every single person on that stage to at least acknowledge the fact that there was a problem and utter the words border security. Okay? Not, you would think not a terribly difficult standard to establish, but it took a while. And I kept pressing it and pressing it and pressing it at every single debate. And eventually, after time, it just was amazing, you know? It did start to change. And all of them would at least give lip service to it. And the last one was McCain, who said something like, well, I got the message. I got the message. Now, he got the message. What he wanted to do with it was something entirely different, but said he got the message. And I remember, this goes to show you my political acumen, because I remember leaving the race that, oh, I was in this a motel in Iowa. It was December. It was snowing. It was cold. It was about 11 o'clock. It was a dumpy motel. I remember there was a I wish I could have taken a picture of this little sign that was on the mirror, because that really does encapsulate it, because it said, please don't use our towels to wash your car. But there I was, and I was eating a hamburger and my dinner, 11 o'clock at night, snowing, lousy cold, and I turn on the TV, and here is a commercial for Rudy Giuliani. And he says, if the people of Iowa will support my position, I will defend our borders. I'll stop. And I'm thinking, my God. And I picked up the phone, and I called Bay Buchanan, and I said, Bay, pull the plug. The last domino has just fallen. And that was it. We 2 days later left the race, and I had done what I thought I had. But I told my wife upon leaving. Now listen, this goes to show you, as I say, my political acumen. I said, well, honey, we've done everything we could do. I've done everything I can possibly do, and in this situation, and they're all there. I said, you know, McCain. But I said, McCain, he's finished. I said, he's $25 million in debt. Behind at all the polls, he's finished. So we don't have to worry about him. Goes to show you. So anyway, I wanted to talk today about the politics of immigration reform, and I call it the, you know, Transformers. You know, they're fine in the movies, but they really make lousy politicians. What I mean by that is, I don't know if you've seen the movie, but I've had to with my grandchildren. I actually liked it, but the you know, these Transformers, these big robot things. Turn into, they start out as a robot and then they turn into a car or something else, I don't know. And that's what we see happen, of course, in politics way too often, that when people are talking to you about their position in their hometown or state, you hear one thing, they go to Congress and they transform into something else entirely. I'm going to talk a little bit about why that happens and what we've got to, how we've got to deal with this. Because it's a major, and it's a phenomenon I observed over and over and over again. First of all, it's fascinating to realize that really it's not been, you know, immigration was really not a significant political issue in our nation. It was out there as a policy discussion point for a while, but it really wasn't all that significant until... Not even during the you know, high tide of immigration, 1890s, 1900. I mean, it was out there. Teddy Roosevelt, of course, talked about it and was not afraid to say that if you wanted to come to this country, that was okay, but there was a requirement, and that is that you become an American. And that meant no hyphen before the name. It meant your complete devotion to this country, severing of those connections that you had, especially political affiliation, political affinity for the country of origin. And he said something then that was so prophetic. Who would have thought it? Because he talked about the fact that although the United States, you know, was accepting millions of immigrants from all over the world, and that was okay, because of course there was a demand. That was another issue, another important thing. What was fueling it? There was a demand for cheap labor. And so the doors were open. But he said, if you have massive immigration without assimilation, he said, this country ceases to be what it is and turns into nothing more than a polyglot boarding house. Right? That was Teddy Roosevelt. So he was the only one, he was the first one really to focus on immigration, even for a short period of time, and talk about what the policy implications were, what were the societal implications for massive immigration. He sort of broached the subject. Well, we've had, as a result, I mean, we've had many, that's another important part to remember about the immigration history and politics. And that is that it has been very cyclical, or it had been a very cyclical phenomena. We had periods of very low immigration, periods of very high, followed by periods of very low, periods of very high. And what we did, really, what wasn't on purpose necessarily, but what happened during those periods of low immigration, is that gave us time to assimilate the people that did come. And there were, of course, all kinds of pressures to assimilate, not only from the people themselves, like my grandparents, but from the society in general. If you wanted to get ahead, you had to do a couple of things in America. One was, of course, learn English. That's exactly right. And that was the most important aspect of assimilation, because along with language comes all kinds of things, connections to a society. Okay? Common language, common connections, common values. Okay. So that was very important. My grandparents, I will never forget. Both sets came to the United States in the 1890s. Both sets, by the way, I don't know why, but I'm glad they did. You know, they straight to Colorado. Well, I do know why. I mean, there was a coal mine and that sort of thing. And so people said, hey, there's a work here. And from that village, people came over. And that was what happened. And so they were coming essentially for the same reasons that everybody else was coming and has been coming. That is to say, a better life, more economic opportunity, escaping the depressed economic conditions in their home country. Same old thing. But there was this one great difference. And that when they got here, there was a desire on their part to cut those ties and to become Americans. That is a lot different than the kind of immigration we have today. And so I talk about illegal immigration, but I talk about immigration in general. It's because legal or illegal, it doesn't matter. If you have massive immigration without assimilation, you've got great problems. And we're witnessing them, and we've been witnessing them for some time.